Why is it so tough to go to Alpha Centauri? How long would it take us to go there? So you're dying to get to Alpha Centauri. Not you personally, of course. Let's say you're hoping humanity can get there soon, right? But when? And what will we send up there? Humans or machines? It's not an easy question to answer, but before diving into that, let's recap the situation a bit. Alpha Centauri is a system made up of three stars. Alpha Centauri A, officially Rigil Kentaurus, Alpha Centauri B, officially Toliman, and Alpha Centauri C, officially Proxima Centauri. Alpha Centauri A and B form a binary pair of sun-like stars orbiting their common center of gravity, while Proxima Centauri is a red dwarf orbiting the main pair at a distance of about 0.2 light years. Then there's Proxima B, a planet orbiting Proxima at about 0.049 astronomical units, over 20 times closer than Earth is to the Sun, but still within the star's habitable zone. Proxima is only 4.246 light years from Earth, roughly 40 trillion kilometers, making it the closest star to our solar system. This also makes Proxima B the closest known exoplanet to Earth and the 8th on the list for Earth Similarity Index among all cataloged exoplanets. So it's no surprise that since its discovery in 2016, Proxima B has become the largest for a potential interstellar mission. This marked a significant leap into our determination to achieve this feat. Before its discovery, our desire to reach Alpha Centauri was rather vague and ambitious, but with the discovery of a potentially habitable planet, we finally had a clear goal. Isn't it true that Proxima B could become our second Earth in the distant future? Okay, folks, let's not kid ourselves. The distance to Proxima Centauri, our nearest star, is 266,000 times greater than the distance to the Sun, and 103 million times greater than the distance we had to cover to reach the Moon. Impressive, right? Even a beam of light traveling at the maximum speed allowed by the laws of physics takes 4.3 years to reach us from Proxima, while it takes less than 8.5 minutes to bridge the gap between us and the Sun. These numbers, in their relentless inevitability, encapsulate the problem of interstellar travel, a daunting abyss of time and space. End of the line, then? Unlucky to have drawn such a high hurdle? Well, maybe not, actually. The data indicates that the typical distance between stars within 30 light years of the Sun is about 9 light years, more than twice the distance to Proxima. Statistically, much closer than expected, then. In light of these facts, we might need to revise our initial impression and conclude that we've been quite lucky to have such a similar star system so close by. Sure, it could have been better, but it wouldn't have been logical to expect a star right in our backyard, with all the possible gravitational consequences, some of which could be quite negative. This allows us to look at the endeavor with a bit of confidence and optimism. Optimism that, however, plummets when we consider our current ability to mount a mission capable of us getting there. To realize our current technological shortcomings, we just need to reflect on the fact that Voyager 1, currently the fastest human-made interstellar object, is moving away from the Sun at 61,000 kilometers per hour, or 38,000 miles per hour, a speed that, if maintained, would allow it to reach a star at Proxima's distance in no less than 75,000 years. While if we relied on the fastest probe ever launched, the Parker Solar Probe, capable of reaching 700,000 kilometers per hour or 435,000 miles per hour, we could make it in just over 6,500 years. A bit too long to ignite our dreams. It's clear then that traditional chemical fuel engines, even with the gravity assist from Jupiter and Saturn, are entirely inadequate for such distances, and a drastic technological leap is necessary. In this regard, many ideas have been proposed, from rockets that use nuclear fission and fusion to those powered by matter-antimatter annihilation to enormous light sails. These are only theoretical solutions, which would still require decades of development and enormous technological and economic efforts to materialize. For a distant future, and still to be verified, some have proposed the use of warp drives, which exist only in our imagination, or wormholes, so far only imagined. Fanciful solutions based on extreme hypotheses of general relativity, which some say could allow travel at speeds greater than light. But unfortunately, it's not just about building bigger, better, and faster spaceships. It's not just about waiting for science and technology to take their course. As we will see shortly, there is a physical impossibility that slows down, if not prevents, our plans for free and fast navigation in the galaxy. For interstellar travel to become appealing to humans, triggering that cocktail of aspiration, ambition, curiosity, and competition that motivates our greatest endeavors, we would need to significantly increase speed. But this is absolutely impossible for several reasons, and this impossibility is also demonstrated by the implicit conclusions of the famous Fermi Paradox. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity Channel. Click on the bell, you'll help us to make products of even higher quality. As Albert Einstein first noted in 1905 in his special theory of relativity, no object with mass can exceed the speed of light. Einstein established this limit based on considerations that seemed, and still seem, to clash with the common sense with which we are used to evaluating the physical phenomena of our daily lives. But this does not change the fact that the limit has been verified in many experiments. And as far as matter and the universe we know are concerned, there is no longer any reason to doubt its existence. Einstein demonstrated that the energy, E, of any object is related to its mass, M, according to the famous equation E equals mc squared, where C is the speed of light equal to 299,792.458 kilometers per second, or 186,302 miles per second in a vacuum. This relationship indicates, among other things, that energy and mass are equivalent entities that can transform into each other. This is exactly what happens when we accelerate an object, even if we don't notice it. The energy we impart to it slightly increases its mass. As the speed increases, however, more and more energy is required to further increase the speed, because more energy is converted into mass. This mass increases the system's inertia, opposing further increases in speed. In practice, the closer you get to the speed of light, the more massive and immovable the object becomes. For example, if traveling at 99.9% of the speed of light, an 80-kilogram person would have a mass of about 2 tons. Thus, trying to provide more thrust to the object or spacecraft to surpass the light barrier would only exponentially increase its mass, leaving the speed practically unchanged. This is why the speed C can be approached but never reached. Objects with mass, in short, resist being accelerated to speeds close to that of light, and the closer you get to that speed, the harder it becomes to accelerate them further. And even if some magical device could instantly reach the speed of light, it would still take 4.3 years to get to Proxima Centauri. This means that even traveling at the maximum speed achievable in our universe, our species could, at most, explore the vicinity of the Sun, but certainly could not establish a network of trade routes across the entire galaxy. But let's not give up so quickly. Maybe we're missing something. Yes, because mass is not the only quantity that varies with speed. Another factor to consider in relativistic space travel is time dilation. Contrary to what classical physics postulates, time does not flow uniformly for all observers, but rather more slowly the closer the observer measuring a given event gets to the speed of light. Leaving aside the physical and mathematical explanation, we must trust the fact, absolutely verified, that on board a spaceship leaving Earth and accelerating to relativistic speeds, time passes more slowly compared to the planet it just left. Imagine a spaceship traveling at 95% of the speed of light to a planet 9.5 light-years away. A stationary observer on Earth would measure the journey time as distance divided by speed, or 9.5 divided by 0.95 equals 10 years. The spaceship crew members, on the other hand, experience time dilation and thus perceive the trip as taking only 3.12 years. In other words, between leaving the Earth and reaching their destination, the crew members age a little over 3 years, while 10 years have passed for people back on Earth. This time discrepancy arises from a very simple formula, which can also predict, for example, that if a spaceship accelerates to 50% of C, then for its crew, time will pass 1.15 times more slowly than on Earth, while at 75% of C, time will seem to pass 1.5 times more slowly. If the speed reaches 99% of C, time on board will pass 7 times more slowly, and so on. At 99.99% of C, time will pass 70 times more slowly, and if the speed reaches 99.9999999% of C, then on board the spaceship time will pass 22,300 times more slowly, until at 100% of C it will seem to stop completely. These numbers, which might induce some optimism about the possibility of moving freely within the galaxy, reveal something shocking. They tell us, in practice, that for an observer moving with their spaceship at around 100% of the speed of light, their journey to any destination, whether 100 light-years or 100,000 light-years away, will be practically instantaneous. Don't believe it? Here's a striking example. We want to travel from Earth to the Andromeda Galaxy, which is about 2.5 million light-years away. If the journey were conducted with an acceleration capable of bringing the spaceship to a speed of 99.99% of C, it would obviously take about 2.5 million years. But in reality, on board the spaceship, the perceived duration would be only 35,000 years. Not only that, by increasing the speed by just a tiny bit, just 30 kilometers per second, we would reach 99.9999999999% of the speed of light. And then Andromeda could be reached in just over 11 years. Incredible, right? If it were really possible, then we could indeed realize the much-dreamed-of Star Trek scenario, where spaceships travel effortlessly from one point to another in the galaxy. So does time dilation solve the problem? Well, unfortunately, no. As we saw earlier, to accelerate a mass more and more until it approaches the speed of light, it would ultimately require practically infinite energy. No known form of propulsion could give us this gift. And even if the energy problem were somehow solved with methods we cannot currently foresee, there's also the fact that a spaceship traveling at a speed very close to that of light would be in a particularly dangerous position. Space is not empty. It's actually full of wandering atoms, which sometimes gather into more complex forms like gas and dust clouds, galaxies, stars, and planets, while other times they remain solitary atoms traveling towards nothingness and probably won't collide with another atom for thousands of years. But one thing is the probability of a collision between two hydrogen atoms in a cubic centimeter of space. Another matter is the certainty of the enormous flow of particles that will collide with the spaceship during its journey. Particles that are almost harmless at low speeds, but with acceleration, they turn into a deadly rain of projectiles and highly penetrating ionizing radiation, capable of severely damaging the hull and making it dangerously radioactive for the occupants. These particles, intercepted at speeds close to that of light, would acquire such great energy as to become lethal for any form of life on board. Not to mention that at such speeds, even passing through a thin nebular veil could completely destroy the spaceship. Some scientists believe that interstellar matter alone will be enough to prevent a spaceship from reaching speeds greater than 1/10 of the speed of light, which, as we've seen, is absolutely insufficient to support a network of large-scale commercial and exploration routes. Even if all these difficulties were overcome, there would still be another insurmountable problem. Time dilation would cut all ties between the traveling spaceship and its home planet. Only the crew would benefit from this time shortening, while for the inhabitants of Earth, time would continue to flow at its usual pace. So for the 11 years perceived by the crew would be 2.5 million years for them. The astronauts would leave knowing they would never see their families, relatives, or friends again, unless they brought them along or didn't have them at all. Upon their return, they would find a society profoundly different from the one they left. Moreover, such a method of travel could not allow for the existence of interstellar institutions, like the United Federation of Planets suggested in Star Trek, based on commercial and cultural exchanges between different races, which presuppose a homogeneous level of technological and social progress. homogeneity that is not compatible with the times required for interstellar travel is conceived. What could motivate a future commercial enterprise to send its goods to the other end of the galaxy, knowing it would never see or communicate with the spaceship carrying its cargo again? Any spaceship venturing into the realm of Einsteinian relativity would become, in practice, a world unto itself, without a homeland and without a past. So what would be the point? Indeed, this is a scenario destined never to materialize. Enrico Fermi tells us this with the logic of his famous paradox. The Italian physicist asked, if our galaxy really hosts technologically advanced civilizations, why aren't their representatives already here? A question that can be answered with a simple consideration. The universe, as we know it, has existed for about 13 billion years. And based on what has happened to our species, it takes 5 billion years for a planet of a solar type star to generate intelligent life. This means that millions of civilizations evolved before ours and had eons to develop technology capable of space travel. Their absence is therefore proof that traveling from one star to another at the speed of light is an endeavor beyond the capabilities of any civilization. And thus, the answer to Fermi's question is this. If they're not here, it does not mean that extraterrestrials do not exist, but simply that physics does not provide solutions capable of nullifying distances. Neither warp drives nor space-time tunnels. Nothing at all. We, like all other inhabitants of the galaxy, are destined to remain confined to our little backyard, content with a few laborious exploratory trips to the two or three nearest stars. This is all in terms of exploration conducted with human crews. The situation would be different if interstellar exploration meant launching small automated probes instead. Initially, missions directed at the stars will likely be conducted with intelligent robotic probes, miniaturized beyond any currently conceivable limits, capable of traveling at 0.1C. But just extrapolating a bit from the extraordinary progress in biotechnology, genetic and molecular engineering, embryonic development and cellular physiology, it becomes clear that even with simple probes like these, humans themselves could quickly spread throughout the galaxy, as proposed by physicist Frank J. Tipler and described by Arthur C. Clarke in the fascinating novel The Songs of Distant Earth. In practice, this would involve creating so-called von Neumann probes, intelligent and automated, that upon reaching their destination would be able to build copies of themselves and habitats for any living beings, including humans, from available raw materials, synthesized on site from genetic code information and instructions for embryo generation and development. Once the colonization of a world is successfully initiated, the von Neumann probes could then build new interstellar spacecraft and new automation destined to fly to other star systems to repeat the process. The propulsion? Sails. A promising proposal is represented by StarWisp laser sails, where the problems of mass and heat are solved by eliminating the engine, replaced by the pressure exerted by a beam of radiation directed at an ultra-light sail. However, the problems of energy and travel duration must be addressed with highly innovative solutions. Since the original idea was formulated in the early 1980s, the concept of the interstellar sail has undergone several revisions and improvements, mainly to limit the energy requirements of the journey and make its operation more plausible. In any case, the main elements of the system would consist of a powerful laser or microwave transmitter, probably placed in space, a gigantic lens used to focus the radiation into an extremely culminated beam even at great distances, and the actual interstellar sail, capable of intercepting the radiation and being significantly accelerated by the pressure thus exerted. And when we say sail, we don't mean a racing spinnaker, but something at least 6 kilometers in diameter and weighing only 30 grams. Accelerated to just 0.2C in just 2 weeks, the StarWisp could reach the Alpha Centauri system in just 21 years. So we leave you with this faint hope. Perhaps the youngest among you will witness the launch of the first probes. It won't be like seeing the Enterprise take off, but it will still be a great thrill. Make good use of it.